I'm Rob from Salsify. I'm here today to talk about the blockchain and in particular to talk about the effects that it might have on commerce. My background, just so you know, before I became a world famous whiteboard video producer, is I actually studied math and computer science back in college. I was a double major. And after that, I worked for IBM for a bunch of years where I worked on distributed systems. So between my studying of math and cryptography and working on distributed systems, I actually have a pretty good background to reason about where blockchain might be headed for commerce in general. I'd like to start, though, with a little primer for those of you who aren't exactly familiar with what the technology does. And before diving into it, I want to contrast it with the way that things work today and what blockchain is looking to address or disrupt. Today, most coordinated activities at scale are done through some type of a mediator, right? People will sometimes use the pejorative word middleman as some kind of evil thing, but the mediators provide a very valuable service in society. So for example, let's say that someone orders a product over the internet and they pay for it with a credit card and the product doesn't show up or shows up broken. You can call the credit card and you can dispute the charge. And the mediator, you know, a Visa, American Express, can reverse the charge on your behalf. They provide a protection mechanism, right? Similarly, if you look at the supply chain, a technology like GDSN, the mediator provides identification verification and other services like that. So that if you're a retailer, if you're Walmart, and you're receiving data over GDSN from a supplier like Coca-Cola, you know that the data that's coming through is actually from Coca-Cola and not from somebody else. And if there's a mistake in the data, there's mechanisms and communication pathways to resolve it. There's interesting features and functionality, therefore, that are provided by these mediators in order to make functions work. Now, with blockchain in particular, what blockchain does is it provides fundamentally what's called the distributed ledger. A distributed ledger means that the ledger doesn't exist in one place. It's not controlled by one entity. It's controlled effectively by everybody who's using it in concert with each other. And I'll give you an example of the impact of that by asking what happens if someone tries to cheat, right? So here we've got four users of a distributed ledger. They each have a copy of the ledger, and they're all coordinating activity, right? So they can send, for example, a Bitcoin. This guy can pay this guy a Bitcoin, and everybody in the entire system knows that that transaction happened, right? Now, if somebody like this evil villain comes in here and tries to create a fake Bitcoin or steal a Bitcoin from somebody else, the distributed nature of the ledger enables everybody else to call BS on that faulty transaction, right? So there's security in the way that the distributed trust is organized within blockchain. That's fundamental to systems, without getting into the cryptography and all that type of stuff. That's fundamentally what the blockchain technology provides, is a distributed form of coordinating activity, a distributed form of trusting actions of others. Okay, does that make sense? So what you see people that are very, very fanatical about blockchain talking about is ways to effectively use this technology to blow up systems where they're upset about the mediator existing. One of the canonical examples is real estate in countries where there's not a very strong central government, right? If I, for example, buy a piece of property from somebody else and there isn't a good form of title management for a particular country, if you've got some type of distributed ledger where everybody registers their property through the distributed ledger and transfers property through the distributed ledger, then there's a way to verify whether or not the property has actually transferred hands and who it actually belongs to and those types of things. So they think, well, in the absence of a very strong mediator, we can provide mediation through distributed coordination, right? Now, I think that type of thing can be super problematic. If you're expecting a technology to help mediate in situations where there's a physical object involved. So I'll give you an example. My father was a Cuban refugee. We still have the deed to our house in Havana. I'm not getting it back, right? That's never coming to me. At the end of the day, guns beat data. Guns beat trust. Right? So a technology doesn't solve the realities on the ground with some of these things. So if I go back to the Visa example, For instance, let's say that I purchase something over some type of a blockchain-enabled commerce system, and I pay for it, and then the good is never received. I've got no means to get my money back. I've got no means to dispute. With Bitcoin, if you send the Bitcoin over the system, it's gone, right? There's other issues with the distributed nature of this, which is that they're really, really costly. So, for example, the Bitcoin network, people estimate that the power used in order to do the proof of work so that coordination could happen in a trusted and secure way uses more power than the entire country of Denmark uses right now. It's something like 35 terawatt hours or something like that. It's just an absolutely insane amount of power in order to make this work. So you see companies that are out there that are playing with ideas on how to apply this distributed coordination, distributed trust characteristics of the blockchain technology into other problems. And they don't exactly address some of the shortcomings that are happening right now. There's real issues at stake when you're trying to coordinate physical control of an object, real estate, a good shipped over the network, for example, with what's happening on the information world. The biggest example of an experiment on this right now is Walmart and IBM coordinating on a transparent supply chain initiative. There's great videos on the internet that explain what the initiative is for. The initiative itself is a great initiative. The goal is you want to have more transparency on the supply chain from where, for example, a consumable is grown to how it's shipped, where it's shipped, what are the conditions of the shipment, all the way across the supply chain to the point that it ends up in the consumer's hands. And having transparency and having knowledge of that information is really, really useful at the end of the day. It's really great for the consumer, especially. How does blockchain help you solve that? I'm not actually 100% sure why that's any better than a mediated system. There's a large computational overhead here. You lack the ability for a mediator to correct any issues that happen within the system. And the blockchain technology itself doesn't do the hard parts of supply chain transparency, which are the physical parts of it, right? Just because you say something is true on the blockchain doesn't mean that the physical aspect of it is true. Doesn't mean that the weather was what you said it was. Doesn't mean that the good is as heavy as you said. Somebody still needs to do that actual physical verification of the truth if it's going to go onto one of these ledgers. Those expensive, hard problems are not actually solved directly by the technology itself. So from my perspective, I see companies and CIOs out there asking the question, should we do anything with blockchain? Should we invest in it? Are there experiments we can run? Are there experiments that we can run internally, and so on and so forth? My opinion of it right now is that we're in early days. There are some interesting characteristics that the technology allows for. I'm not sure where the killer apps are going to be yet for this. I think it's a little premature for most organizations to invest heavily in blockchain. It's at best an experimentation. Where I would invest for commerce is I would invest, how do you get on Amazon's fast track program? How do you make sure that you can drop ship eaches of every size, shape, and color that are available to you as an organization? There's logistical and IT problems that are serious problems that you have to solve in order to get those things right. How do you win on voice search? That's a new and unexplored area. Serious IT creativity resources need to be brought to bear in order to win on that, and so on and so forth. There's real problems that you could be working on today that have known benefit to your organization and that are going to really require resources and thought in order to get right. This, I'm not sure what the benefit to the organization is. I'm not sure what the killer app is. I can see a lot of challenges in terms of moving a world from here to here and things that you give up in a functioning economy like the United States, but you know, I think it's still TBD. So I hope that's helpful. I know this is a lot of information. Feel free to DM me or send me an email if you want to get into this in a little bit more detail. But that's the quick overview on blockchain. And my initial skepticism as to where it's going to impact commerce today.